Switched over to 5:30, so I will go ahead and convene this closed session of the Board of Directors of San Lorenzo Valley Water District for June 3rd, 2021. Molly, would you please call the roll?
President Mayhood?
Here.
Vice President Henry?
Here.
Director Ackman?
Here.
Director Faltz?
Here.
Director Smalley?
Here.
Are there any additions and deletions to the closed system, closed session agenda?
Staff has none.
Okay. And then that brings us to the time for oral communications regarding things on the closed agenda. I don't see any outside attendees. So unless seeing none, hearing none, I guess I will adjourn us to closed session. Okay, so we'll see you in a few minutes back on the other channel.
Thank you.
Guys. let's see, I don't see Jamie, do I? Is she back?
I don't see her either.
Has not made the...
It is 6:30, so we should probably...
I don't see Mark Smalley either. Oh, there you are. Never mind.
Jamie's coming on.
Jamie, she's coming on right now.
All right. With that... then I would like to convene the open session of the June 3rd, 2021 meeting of the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District. Holly, can you, let's see, actually we report actions taken in closed session first. And Gina, would you like to read the statement that the board asked you to prepare?
Yes, I'll do that, Chair Mayhood. The board voted unanimously to make an announcement out of closed session for the information of the public that the district has been informed that the county intends to file an amended complaint in its lawsuit against the district, which the district has not seen yet.
Okay, thank you. With that, can I get Holly to call the roll call?
President Mayhood?
Here.
Vice President Henry?
Here.
Director Ackman?
Here.
Director Faltz?
Here.
Director Smalley?
Here.
Thank you.
Are there any additions and deletions to the agenda?
Staff has none.
Okay. With that then, we pass to the section on oral communications, and this is the part of the agenda where we have communications from the public on any subject that lies within the purview of the district but is not on tonight's agenda. And let's see, I see we have three attendees. Would any of them like to make a comment at this point? Seeing none, hearing none, we'll go ahead and go on to new business. And the first item of new business is the vegetation fire management plan. District Manager Rick Rogers.
Thank you, Chair Mayhood. Yes, the environmental planner will present this agenda item to the board and public. Carly?
Great, thank you. Just to begin this item, I'd like to make a clarification on the recommendation. We want to split that recommendation up into two. So the first recommendation will be for the Board of Directors to review and accept Panorama's presentation on the fire and vegetation management plan, and then followed by the Board of Directors to adopt the fire and vegetation management plan itself. Just as a brief background for both recommendations, as many of us are aware, the fires of 2020 burned approximately 1,600 acres of the district's watershed land and damaged and or destroyed infrastructure. Prior to the fires, the district began work on a fire and vegetation management plan to expand mapping create and prioritize fuel reduction projects, improve communications with fire prevention agencies, and identify funding sources. In April, the Environmental Committee reviewed the plan and recommended board adoption. The Environmental Committee's feedback and recommendations have been incorporated into the final version of the plan. And then prior to adoption, we have Panorama Environmental Inc., who created the plan for the district, ready to present the final version, its overview, its updates since last review, and fuel reduction projects the district is currently pursuing. So please welcome Tanya Trace and Caitlin Gillerin. And then if CTV could maybe add Tanya Trace as a presenter, I think she did not receive her invite.
I think I'm on now, Carly.
Oh, great.
She is on.
Great. Yeah. And should I share the presentation? Sorry. Or was that on your end?
Yeah, if you can share it, there should be the share screen at the bottom.
Yep, I have access. Okay, great. Thank you. Take a second here. There we go.
Great. Thank you, Tanya. Mm-hmm. Hello, everybody. My name is Caitlin Gillerin, and as Carly mentioned, I'm with Panorama Environmental, and we also have Tanya Trace, principal with Panorama, here with us. Jason Mogada is also part of our team and was not able to attend, but we as a team prepared this plan that we're presenting to you tonight. Next slide. So I'll be going through an overview of the plan, and I'm going to be focusing mostly on what's different since the February board meeting and the April Environmental Committee meeting. And then I'm also going to get into the grant applications that we've done with San Lorenzo Valley Water District, which are primarily focused on project implementation for the projects that are in the plan. Okay. Next slide. All right, so this slide presents sort of an overview of quite a few of the factors that are present in the general area of district lands that result in the increased risk of wildfire, including the high fuel loads outside the CZU complex perimeter, as there has not been a burn there, as well as post-wildfire mortality within the CZU complex perimeter, compounded, of course, by the longer and more frequent droughts and hotter weather. The overall plan purpose is to lessen the presence, is to present projects and recommendations to lessen the presence of unnaturally high fuel loads on district-owned lands and around district-owned assets, primarily, of course, critical water infrastructure to reduce the intensity and harmful impacts of wildfires. This slide, the next slide, present the general plan content. And I just want to highlight a few of the key sections, the executive summary, expanded prioritization process, and additional costing breakdowns are in direct response to board and environmental committee comments. And I'm going to dig really into the prioritization process later in the presentation. Generally, the recommended treatments identifying this plan fall into two main categories, the near-term post-fire recovery treatments and defensible space, fuel reduction, and material upgrades. The plan also delves into some potential options that the district can consider for long-term, larger-scale management of district lands. This slide provides an overview of some of the key appendices that I just want to highlight. Particularly of note, I would recommend taking a look at the higher priority project appendix. This also addresses the environmental committee comments, and I'll be getting into what those projects consist of later on. As a high-level overview, the near-term post-fire recovery treatments are really focused on hazard tree identification and removal, as well as reforestation in the burn areas. The prioritization process will go into greater depth of how and where those treatment areas are. So when we met with the environmental committee, we were in progress meeting with the fire agency and conducting site visits in March, which we incorporated the applicable recommendations and helped us kind of lay out some other recommendations for the fuel reduction in defensible space. And actually a lot of the recommendations from fire agency staff really jive with the treatments that were already proposed, including establishing defensible space around water tanks and other critical water infrastructure, as well as maintenance and vegetation clearance around roads. The recommendations also touch on infrastructure upgrade options. So this section are the three kind of large scale, maybe longer term management options. That would be just kind of like continued maintenance for water infrastructure, clearance of fallen trees, the voluntary carbon market, as well as potentially commercial timber harvesting. There are pros and cons for all of those options. So this is, this slide and the next slide touch on the sort of a high level of the prioritization process that is laid out in the plan. The priority areas for hazard trees are the intersections adjacent to public roadways and occupied structures adjacent to San Lorenzo Valley Water District land. So that would be kind of annual inspections and removal as needed based on those inspections. The prioritization for reforestation are those areas of moderate, high, and very high severe burn areas. And the focus would really be in areas that were previously conifer forests at slopes below 50%. And that's because it's anticipated based on studies that redwood forests will actually resprout even after a severe fire like the CBU complex. This slide outlines the seven general categories for prioritization of defensible space, fuel reduction, and material upgrades. The priorities really are focused, at least initially, on the areas outside the CBU complex. The very highest priority types of projects are defensible space treatments within 100 to up to 300 feet as it is possible around water infrastructure. Then we go down into upgrade water infrastructure, fire resistant materials, and specific recommendations for the infrastructure upgrades are laid out in Appendix B, which also outlines actually what the district has already planned for those upgrades. The remaining prioritizations are fuel reduction projects around district-owned roads, other adjacent public and private roads, as well as adjacent properties, especially occupied properties. Appendix D provides confidential maps of all the defensible space and fuel reduction areas based on the prioritization listed here. And Appendix E provides a breakdown of acres by area type to get an idea of scale. This slide gets into the seven recommended higher priority projects that were identified. And these projects were developed according to the prioritization process on the previous slide, recommendations from fire agency staff and fire professionals, district staff input, as well as ease of access and implementation, since we want to help make sure that the district can get going as soon as possible. Prioritization was based on conditions at the time the plan was prepared, and these priorities can change depending on funding availability, partnerships, and other considerations. So the district isn't stuck only, you know, going linearly down the list. For example, you can mix and match. And I also just do want to make a note that there are some estimated costs for each of these recommended higher priority projects that's provided in Appendix F. The plan also has a section that describes potentially appropriate permitting and environmental review that really varies depending on the scope and scale of the projects that are to be implemented. The general approaches are project level, where you would just do, for example, one of those projects, the recommended higher priority project, or programmatic, where maybe you would do all the environmental permitting for all those projects. The options for project level could be CEQA exemptions or CAL FIRE timber exemption forms, depending on the project and the resources present. You can also look at using coverage under existing environmental documents, such as Cal BTP or Cal Fire BMP EIR. So although there is not specifically a slide on it, because it's just numbers and I didn't want to overwhelm anybody, the plan does also outline estimated costs for treatment and permitting activities, as well as some infrastructure upgrades. And based on those costs and discussions with the district, we're aware that funding is a key issue for implementation. As such, we've been working with the district to conduct and facilitate outreach and effort to find teaming partners that can include the Resource Conservation District, Fire Council, and many others. We have also found and documented in the plan the wide variety of grants and funding opportunities, and thankfully there have been quite a few lately, and I outlined some of the most relevant ones, especially for really getting on the ground as soon as possible. That California Forest Improvement Grant Program, Fire Prevention Grant Program, California Coastal Conservancy Program, and I'm actually going to go into those a little bit more in just the next slide. So I'm going to, I'm going to touch on the three grants that we helped the district apply for and the status and kind of what those projects are. So the first one is the Forest Management Plan funding through the CFIT program. And this funding has been approved and we can start in on the Forest Management Plan after approval of this plan, as we'll be able to use quite a few of the components and just drop it right in there. Following approval of that forest management plan, the district can then apply for CFIP actual implementation on the ground projects. CFIP covers some fuel management projects such as wide area roadside clearing. The next one is for the Forest Health Grant, and we worked with Carly when the Resource Conservation District came to the district and said that they had a very large Forest Health Grant and wanted to see if the district had any projects, and we did. So we provided a description, mapping, and cost estimate for up to 182 acres of reforestation. And these projects are primarily in higher severity burn areas, as well as some of the eucalyptus. And CalFire provided preliminary approval of that very summary project description, and it's going through the approval process now, and we should know more soon. And then the last one, very exciting, we assisted San Lorenzo in proposing for the funding through that California Coastal Conservancy Forest Health and Wildfire Resilience Program. And that was a very quick turnaround. I think it was just a couple weeks, but thankfully, because the plan was pretty much fully formulated at that time, we were able to propose up to 85 acres of defensible space around water infrastructure, as well as some roadside fuel reduction. And it's pending approval and it's anticipated, hopefully on June 7th, we will get the final word on that. So there are a lot of opportunities, a lot of grants coming up, hopefully maybe a September or 2022 cycle. And now with the plan and all the data and the projects in there, it's relatively easy to pull out projects and propose for those fairly quickly. So we will continue to assist San Lorenzo to fund the recommended projects in the plan, stay connected, and apply once they open. Great, and that concludes my presentation, and we are happy to take questions.
Okay. Let's start with Jamie. Do you have any questions or comments you want to make?
So, first of all, when these projects, the grants that would potentially fund these projects that we've applied for or that we're considering, Do these also require matching funds from the district, and are those considered as part of our CZU fire recovery costs, or would these be separate to that?
Yeah, I can answer that, and Carly can jump in if she has anything else she'd like to add. For the Resource Conservation Forest Health and the California Coastal Conservancy, no matching is required. They did recommend that if there was any matching or already planned funds, to mention it, but no matching was required for either of those. The Forest Management Plan grant also has no matching required, but rather it has a cap. So only a maximum amount can be charged.
And then my only other concern, and maybe this is a longer term issue that I'm not even sure you can speak to, but it seems like we're likely to be getting a glut of funding, you know, across the United States, particularly if the stimulus bill goes through, and there will be lots of infrastructure projects that are potentially recipients of that funding. That means that there will be lots of demand for the labor resources to carry out those tasks. And I'm just wondering, you know, as we're thinking about all of these projects that we want to do, if we are successful in getting these grants, are we being realistic about being able to contract in the resources to actually carry out the tasks in a timely fashion to meet the grant application requirements?
Again, I'm going to answer some of that, and Carly can feel free to augment. So based on preliminary discussions, at least for these specific grants, we can't speak for future grants, but it actually sounds like the RCD would like to take on managing the contracting, working with the district rather than having the district manage the reforestation contractors. And then for the the California Coastal Conservancy grant, Carly and our team is actually underway working on getting those contracts together to get the vegetation management contractors on. And part of that would involve one of the contracts would actually be either an RPS or some other sort of project manager to manage the vegetation contractors.
Yeah, Carly, would you like to kind of add to that and clarify whether, I imagine that a lot of these will require consultants to kind of manage some of the projects, and would that be something that we would pay, or would it potentially be part of the grants?
Yeah, it depends. It depends on the grant itself, right? What the grant, these two grants that we're pursuing now, I believe those costs will be covered by the grant funding. So, you know, depending on what we go after in the future, that might be a different scenario. But right now we're trying to get the request for qualifications out, so we do have a list of contractors to contact once we do receive the funding, and then also have that registered professional forester on board to manage all those vegetation and contractors as well.
Okay. Jamie, does that more or less answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Bob?
Yeah, thanks. Just a few comments and a couple of questions. I think this is a really comprehensive report. There's a lot to absorb, so I don't know that I could pass a test on it tomorrow, but it looks very good. And I'm really happy that we've gotten it to this point. I sincerely wish, of course, that we had it done sooner, but things are what they are. And I always like to thank our previous board member, Lou Ferris, and Larry Ford for their work on this early on, getting this going and really jumpstarting our ability to get here. On any of the costs associated with doing these priority projects, and this might be a question for Rick, Caitlin, I don't know. But are any of them, or could any of them be covered partially by FEMA as part of our recovery?
Carly, you want to answer that?
Or Carly?
It looks like Rick's muted. I'm not sure with the FEMA funding. That's probably more of a question for Rick.
Okay, Rick?
We discussed this with FEMA. FEMA will not work on the watershed properties. Not unless there's a facility directly reflected. And we've had discussion if they will approve
some hardening that wasn't impacted by the fire, and we still haven't got answers. The FEMA process is still very much in its beginning stages. We're just starting to get geared up with an actual team of FEMA inspectors this week. And we were bounced around so much in the beginning that we're really starting to get into the nuts and bolts. So we'll have better answers to those questions.
In particular, I'm curious about, you know, the Lyon treatment plant, which we've already taken out a large number of trees, and I believe that is probably going to be covered. But in terms of any additional hardening of that area, since that was directly impacted by the fire.
And you know, the Lyon treatment plant is a good example. If any of these trees are hazards or in reach of any of our facilities, that's straightforward. FEMA will cover. But out into the watershed, they've been very clear that they will not go out into the watershed.
And then the second question is, we did approve a grant writer. And, you know, one of my assumptions is that this particular topic would be a real priority for that person. Do we think that is the case going forward?
Yes, I believe that will be the case, Bob. Right now, we are finalizing the contract with Susan, our grant writer, and in the meantime, we've been working with Panorama before we started working with the grant writer herself. So I believe we'll probably have some coordination between Panorama Environmental and our grant writer to begin, and then kind of let the projects take off from there.
Okay.
Well, then we also, you know, with that grant writer, it's a heavy lift, but we also, you know, as Jamie stated and others, infrastructure money will be coming available, and there may be some potentials for some large funds. So, you know, the grant writer will be busy.
Well, that's good news. I hope very busy. We want a 10x ROI. And then the last question is, in terms of some of the costs on here that may not be covered by grants or FEMA, how much is in next year's budget again for these activities?
We have $50,000 in next fiscal year's budget.
Okay.
And there's also funds for hardening a few facilities as well in next year's budget.
And by hardening, we're talking about concrete block and that sort of thing around our pump stations and the like, right?
Exactly.
Okay, great. Thank you, and great great report, Caitlin. Thank you very much.
Okay, Lois?
I do have a question. I've been having a very difficult time this isn't my question, but understanding the presenter. It's very broken. I don't have that problem with anybody else that's been talking. So I don't know what's going on. So my question is about where we have to get permits. And there are permits that are needed and not needed. And one of the things I read in the plan in section 1.3 was, it said, where existing environmental review does not cover the proposed activity or it's something off the wall kind of thing, then we have to get, my understanding is we have to get separate permits or we have to get our own CEQA plan or whatever. I just wonder if I'm reading that right.
Carly?
Yeah.
Or
Italy? Can you hear me? Lois? I know you said I was breaking up, so I just wanted to make
sure. I really can't understand you for some reason.
I think the rest of us can. So go ahead, Caitlin. And
okay, I'll just answer, and then maybe Tanya can also reiterate if Lois still can't hear me.
I can't hear at all now. Okay, so can Carly answer?
Yeah, I can jump in. So I believe that's referring to some of the CAL FIRE exemptions. So they already have gone through an EIR process that can cover some of these projects, depending on what project we're going after. And then we can also go after exemptions for a lot of these projects for CEQA. So there are different avenues to complete these environmental permitting requirements. And then maybe if Tanya does want to jump in, I think she's still on. She's more than welcome to add some detail to that.
Yeah, that's exactly right, Carly, that, you know, I think a lot of this work will fall under CEQA exemptions, and those are documents you have to produce yourself, but they're very light in terms of what you have to do, noticing and filing them. And, you know, for the types of projects that are in this plan, especially the work coming out in the short term, most of them probably would fall under an exemption. The existing plan that we're talking, that Caitlin was talking about, was the vegetation treatment plan EIR with CAL FIRE. And that also is a little more work than an exemption, but all of the district's areas fall under it in terms of coverage area. So, and most of the activities do. Now, something like hardening wouldn't, but that would likely be an exemption under CEQA. So I think in most scenarios, the environmental and the permitting side is fairly straightforward and streamlined. It's similar, you know, we've been working with other agencies up in Marin, and they're all going through the same sort of process of similar types of projects and how do you streamline and get it done under CEQA. So we're very familiar with, you know, what the options are, and have worked with attorneys on, you know, what's the legally defensible way to do it. You know, where it talked about potential for a bigger document or a CEQA EIR, which sounds concerning, I think that's probably less likely for what we're looking at, you know, in the short term. If there were longer term objectives for larger areas, that might be the case. But I think for what we're looking at in front of us and for the projects and the high priority projects, most of that's going to be a little more streamlined.
Anything else, Lois?
No, I think I heard most of that. So no, thank you.
All right. Mark.
Yes. Again, a good report. We asked at one of the previous board meetings for a list of priorities, and I see that has now been incorporated into the report with a list of high priority mitigation projects. Good. That's what we asked for, and that's what you're coming back with. Carly, who's the lead person at the district managing these various activities, the strategy, kind of how we're pursuing these? Because what I heard from Caitlin was, well, we're not necessarily working on these on a 1-5 basis, but it's kind of fluid as to which one of these we might be working on at any one time.
Right. That's correct. So right now it is kind of a group effort between Rick, James, myself. And then as far as working with Panorama, you know, they're giving their two cents as well. And then we've also received feedback from the local fire agencies and CAL FIRE. So what we kind of were referring to as far as rearranging the priority is, you know, we might get an opportunity to get some grant funding for one of those priorities, which would maybe move it up the list, right? Because then we could complete that project. Or there might be a project to do a tank replacement where we're going to upgrade the pump house as well. So that hardening might jump up the list because it could be part of an infrastructure project we're going after as well.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, I'm pretty much the lead staff with the district. And then we will be hopefully bringing on a registered professional forester to really manage all the projects once they start getting on the ground.
I see. And is that registered forester than a contractor or contract position? Okay. And we've heard the question from at least one of the other board members about costs. For any of these grants that we're considering, will the board know ahead of time any district costs, either staffing time or other money outlays that we're going to need to do if we get the grant before either you or our contract grant writer, put much time into it?
Yeah, For these two grants, we did try to estimate our staff time and include that as either a match or as part of the grant funding. Mm-hmm. So we have taken that into consideration. You know, any of the work for the registered professional forester, I can't imagine that wouldn't be covered as part of the grant since it's actually a part of the implementation.
Right.
But we are trying to make sure we cover all those costs as well for staff hours and the consultants.
Oh, okay. So the grant, those costs, you're including that in the grant request that we're putting together. Right. Good. Okay. Well, thank you. Those are my questions.
Okay. I have a question. Well, first let me say that I appreciate the report. It's very comprehensive and it was, like Bob said, I might not pass a test, but it's there as a reference that I can go back to. I have a question that really is just kind of scientific curiosity. And that is, when we're considering going in and reforesting areas, and we're talking about doing it in the areas that are low gradient, where it's dug fir. Why do we do that rather than just letting nature take its course in terms of, in other words, as we're prioritizing projects? And the reason I ask that is that, you know, for other things, the RCD tells the local folks to just let nature take its course. Maybe they were referring to redwood forests. But the other is it strikes me that from the standpoint of a district that's worried about water in a drought, having increased runoff and less evapotranspiration might actually increase the volume of the creeks in our watershed. And that is not necessarily a bad thing. So can you just kind of address that question?
Yeah, unfortunately we don't have Jason, our registered professional forester, on the project, but Tanya or Caitlin might be able to jump in here.
Yeah, I think this is definitely Jason's wheelhouse over mine or Caitlin's in terms of, you know, the choice of tree. I mean, as Caitlin mentioned, obviously the redwood is will regenerate, and you know, maybe it's that the other types don't as readily. I think also there's, you know, while runoff can be a problem too, so I think there's some science behind sort of giving it a little jump start to get the vegetation, the trees going, so that you don't have as much sediment loss and erosion happening in these areas. But you know, beyond, if Jason was on, he could probably wax on and off for 10 minutes about this for you. So we could probably get you an more of a detailed answer offline. But
you just have, maybe you could ask him just to indulge me, to send me an email and answer that question. And what really motivates that was, we saw some information from the Santa Margarita groundwater basin that evapotranspiration just dwarfs the amount of water that we're pumping out of the ground. And so what you realize is that the trees in the forest have a huge effect on the water cycle. And so, you know, that made me also think that there's a good reason to start managing the undergrowth just to have less things evapotranspirating. But anyway, that's where that question comes from.
If I can add a couple quick things on that, when talking to Jason and others, if some of these areas, if we don't revegetate, you will have the invasives move in, such as broom.
Yeah.
Okay. Which is very problematic for the district to manage. And then in some of the steep areas, erosion. And I would hope we would use redwood instead of Doug fir. Those are two concerns about, you know, letting the sun in and not revegetating and having broom take over on the watershed.
That makes a lot of sense. And it did say only the low slope areas, because redwoods would do the job on their own. Let's go out and if the board doesn't mind, we can come back for another round of questions, but I'd like to go to the attendees for their comments. And I'd like to start with Larry Ford, in part to acknowledge the large role that he and former director DeFerris had in getting us started thinking about these problems. So Larry, go ahead.
Thank you. This is Larry Ford from Felton. I appreciate your compliments about that. I'm really pleased with the process, pleased with Carly's job, really pleased with the Panorama team's job. I reviewed the fire management plan again. I hope you can hear me.
Yes.
Okay, good. Thought I heard something in the background. Anyway, I reviewed the fire management plan, and I think it's it's really an excellent plan, really well done, well presented. I found only one typo, which I'll send Carly an email about. But I think the plan reflects an up-to-date and very thorough professional job. And it, as several people have mentioned, it does provide the several things that were asked for by the Environmental Committee, as well as the Board of Directors and public commentary, including from me. It responded well to those things, and I really appreciate them taking the extra time to do that. I know how hard it is to stay within a budget. Anyway, I think there are three parts of the plan that possibly could be improved. And these are things that probably should be deferred until a later opportunity by somebody like Carly to research it and prepare another addendum to the plan. But those three things are, there really ought to be more detailed goals of what the whole landscape should look like as a result of the vegetation management that's proposed. This is something that's coming up among a lot of professional fire managers and fire ecologists lately, since we've had these several years of catastrophic fires. And we're just trying to figure out, what are we looking for? And one of the, this should be both broadly across the landscape, across the whole watershed, but also these things could apply very specifically to SOV water district lands as well. But one of the best models that I can think of and that I'm trying to study myself is, what did the indigenous people produce after 10 to 12,000 years of fire management and vegetation management? One of the things that the plan didn't cover adequately on page 3-7 was the role of indigenous vegetation management. They talked about forest management, but actually there was a lot of indigenous management of herbaceous and shrubby vegetation as well, for things like baskets and arrows and bows and weirs and other things that they use for non-food purposes. And so there is some research being proposed and being conducted that's answering some of these questions. And as everybody knows, the indigenous people are starting to rise to the occasion here as well. So these sort of broad landscape level goals would also apply to the restoration, reforestation type questions that Gail was asking about. And so I suspect that I know that the landscape looked very different than it does today, or did before the fire. And I'd like to understand better about how they did it. And anyway, as I said, I think this would be a good exercise for Carly to take on in her spare time for the future. The third point I wanted to make is that livestock grazing is much more important than anybody wants to recognize. And it could apply to the SOV Water District land specifically, but the rest of the Santa Cruz Mountains has a lot of grasslands that are grazed by cattle, especially. And this fits into the whole model that Jason described about around the wildland-urban interface. There's a zone inside the wildland-urban interface that's sometimes called the intermix. I like to call it the peri-urban zone. And that is that there's a lot of grazable forage inside the cities and inside the zone where towns are, backyards, vacant lots, abandoned vineyards, and all that sort of thing. And if we could control that fire fuel, we could reduce, my hypothesis is that we could reduce the severity of fires, the throwing off of firebrands and things like that from herbaceous fuels. And so on page 4-4, there wasn't enough discussion about that, but all these things I admit are really kind of academic and for future research. So I'm not blaming the Panorama team for not doing this to meet my academic expectations. So that's it. Thank you. Back to you, Bill.
Well, I'm sharing your academic orientation because I totally lost my mind as the chair and let you go on for way more than 3 minutes because I was fascinated.
Anyway,
that's all right. I'm begging apologies of others, but are there any other of the attendees that would like to make a comment at this point? Of the public, seeing none and hearing none, I'll go back to the board, and Bob has had his hand up for a while.
I just left it up, but I wanted to make a request, actually, that if you received any information about your question, that would be shared with the board in general, because sure. I'm interested in learning about it as well. So thank you for if we could do that. Carly, it may go to you, so if you could distribute it out to everybody, that'd be great. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any other questions from the board? I see Mark, you're shaking your head. No.
I got my hand up.
Jamie, go ahead.
Okay, so a quick question. Will we need to make a decision about whether we want to explore carbon offsets or timber harvesting as future strategies? Like, I wasn't clear that was something that we've already decided on, or is there going to be a future decision point where we have to pursue that?
Yeah, there's no timeline associated this time. Right now, we can have someone come in and do a presentation for the board on the carbon offset market. That could be something that kind of kickstarts that process. But it is kind of up to the board as we want to pursue these different longer term management.
I ask that only because I know RTC has a number of projects that require carbon offsets that they have funding for and are going to construction on, and they're looking for projects in which to invest those carbon offsets. So I don't know if that there is a reason for us to have that conversation or if there's even a desire for us to have that conversation at this point, but I saw in a recent RTC board meeting that conversation was happening about their projects.
We would start those discussions at the environmental committee meeting and then kind of let it grow one way or another from there. Those would be the appropriate, you know, forum to start the discussion and then bring it to the full board if so.
Am I correct on that one, that it isn't maybe a super high priority because the sizes of the land that we're talking about may not be big enough to really be saleable in that sort of market?
Right, we probably have to do an aggregated project with other landowners in the area.
Lois, you had a question.
I did. Well, I had a comment and a question. I listened to what Larry said about grazing animals, and I thought about the goats that used to roam around in Lompico, and they would eat the poison oak. And if you drank their milk, you would not have a problem with poison oak. It because I did have a problem with poison oak, but drinking goat's milk where they've eaten the poison oak, it was no longer a problem. But also those goats kept a lot of grass and things down. The other thing was, I was wondering, okay, why would we plant fir trees? Is it because they grow faster or whatever? I mean, like, redwood trees have a certain resistance to fire, not totally, but they don't burn like other trees. So I was curious why we might plant fir trees.
Yeah, hopefully you can hear me. But no, the plan is not proposing to plant fir trees. And in fact, the only current actual known proposal would involve planting redwood seedling. What the plan is recommending is that the only areas of reforestation are areas that were previously Douglas fir forest, as those will not resprout, whereas previous redwood forest should just be left alone, and no reforestation efforts at this point are recommended, as it is assumed that they will resprout.
Oh, I'm glad you clarified that, Caitlin, because I misinterpreted that the same way that Lois did, that you were going to replant Doug firs, and I couldn't imagine why would we be planting which is probably what Lois was thinking. Okay, that makes a lot of sense. Lois, did you have another question or comment?
Yeah, nope, that was my question. I'm just wondering why.
Okay, any other comments by, doesn't look like we have any more from the board. How about from the public? Okay, so what I'd like to do is just divide the question here, because I think there's kind of two different issues, and maybe this gets back a little bit to Jamie's question of, you know, what we prioritize and what we're buying into right now. And one question is to simply recommend that the district manager accept the report prepared by Panorama. So what I'd like to do is see if somebody would move that question first. Bob?
Just to clarify, is it the district manager accepting the report or the board accepting the report?
If you prefer the board. Okay, let me just restate this.
Or the district accepting report.
That the board of directors accepts the report prepared by Panorama Environmental Inc. on post-fire response and the fire management plan. Okay, is there anybody that would like to do that?
I can do that.
Okay, Jamie moved it. Can I have a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, can we have a roll call vote, Holly? Or wait, I guess we need to have a discussion of that first. Is there anybody that on the board that wants to make a comment on that? Seeing none, hearing none, I'll go out to the public to see if there's anybody there that would like to comment on that. Seeing none, hearing none, then go ahead, Holly.
President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Aye.
Director Ackman?
Yes.
Director Falls?
Yes.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
Okay, great, thank you. Then the other issue, and maybe, I don't know if we may want to have separate conversation about this, but let me just sort of frame it first, and then we can see if we have a motion on the table. And that would be in this case that we adopt the post-fire response and fire management plan that was prepared by Panorama Environmental Inc. So what we're doing in that case is we're essentially directing the staff to take that plan and implement it. And so I think what we're asking for at this point is if the board or the members of the public see anything in which they strongly disagree with priorities or any of the other things that are recommended to be done. Are there any members of the board that would like to comment on that? Let's see, I can't see everybody all at once, so yell out your name if you want to speak. I don't hear anybody wanting to speak. How about members of the public? All right. Then can I get somebody to move the motion as I described it?
I'll move the motion as you described it.
Okay. Thank you, Lois. Anybody to second?
I'll second that.
Okay. Then Holly, can you call a roll call vote?
President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Aye.
Director Ackman?
Yes.
Director Falls?
Yes.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
Then that was unanimous. And we can move on to our next item of new business, which is the augmentation of the Panorama contract. And Carly, are you going to handle this discussion?
Yes, thank you. So as everyone's now familiar with our previous item of Panorama Environmental, we brought the district to create a fire and vegetation management plan in 2020. So now that that plan has been adopted by the board, Panorama has also begun assisting the district with implementation and securing funding, as discussed in the presentation. Those projects include post-fire recovery, critical asset hardening, preparation of the forest management plan, grant funded, implementation of proposed projects, and associated environmental permitting, pending most of those pending grant funding as well. It is important to note that Panorama has also taken on a number of tasks outside of their scope, particularly during the fire emergency. Tasks include fire hazard tree assessments, watershed restoration planning, identifying emergency response grants, organizing site visits with state agencies, erosion control and debris removal permitting, potential funding through the carbon market, and valuable feedback on various fire-related topics. Most recently, Panorama has assisted the district with securing grant funding to complete priority projects as outlined in the fire management plan through partnerships with the Resource Conservation District of Santa Cruz County and the California Coastal Conservancy. Panorama's contract amendment scope and fee sheets are included in the agenda packet. It is important to note that the task six is dependent on the district receiving grant funding, and task seven also has the potential for grant reimbursement upon award. Staff and Panorama are prepared to answer any questions the board have.
Okay, I'll start with Director Fultz.
Yes, thank you, Carly, for that. I had a couple of questions. Am I correct in reading this, that this is actually sort of a catch-up a contract? That is, that they've already done the work and they need to get paid.
That is correct.
Yeah. Okay. Is there anything outside of things that would be covered for by grant funding? Is there anything that would go into next year's budget? Because I'm assuming if we pay them now, that's going to go into this year's budget.
Right. So we have a separate, we'll probably receive a completely separate scope from Panorama for next fiscal year. And that we do have a budget for in my environmental budget.
And is that the 50K or is that, sorry, that is the 50K we talked about earlier in the last right. one. Okay. And then the last question is regarding the budget, is there money to cover this? That is, and still stay within our budget for this fiscal year?
No, we're outside of that budget that we had. We also allocated $50,000 in the last year's fiscal year budget.
Yeah. And so this would take us to a total of what?
We also completed another augment in January, and I'm not sure if that cost off the top of my head. Maybe Caitlin or Tanya, if you remember.
Yep.
Put you guys on the spot as well. Let me see if I can find that information, Bob, and get that to you.
Is it somewhat closer to 100,000, do you think?
I would say it's under 100,000.
100,000. Okay. And then, but from a point of view of our overall San Lorenzo Valley Water District budget, we still have funds available to be able to cover this.
I believe so. Rick, I don't know if you want to jump in there. And it's also important to note, you know, with this incoming grant funding, one of the grants will probably be around $200,000, and then the other is probably going to be closer to maybe 400,000. So
yeah, no, I get the ROI. I just want to make sure we're staying in budget. On an overall district basis, you know, things go up and down, and you know, there's always unforeseen things. So this is a good one to do.
Right. And you know, their original scope of work, they went outside of that and assisted the district in fire recovery, and that's where most of these additional
cost. They were very instrumental in a lot of this recovery with CAL FIRE, with the foresters and those type of things.
Okay.
But does any of that get covered by FEMA then, Rick?
I don't believe so. Maybe some of it might on the roadways, and we had some tree review of some hazard trees. That's possible. There was a couple of hazard trees and some other things that are possible. We can look into that.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Lois, did you have any comments?
No questions, no comments.
Okay. How about you, Mark?
Yes. In the third paragraph, Carly, you talk about tasks out of scope. And I understand from Rick's comment just a minute ago that some of this was done during the fires. But did Panorama provide you any sense of, and here's what the approximate cost for any of this is going to be before they were going ahead with it? Or was this go, go, go.
Right. Not during the emergency. It was kind of a go, go, go. We needed the assistance and we kind of just had them jump in where they could.
Mm-hmm. But after the fact, is any of this after the fact work?
I guess not.
Okay.
The questions.
Okay. And I see in there, in Panorama's scope of work, that they refer to some June 7th, the Coastal Conservancy Board that, have we already submitted then for that? Okay, so that's now, you're not asking us to give any concurrence or approval on that. That's already happened. Okay. They refer in their proposal to GIS management and mapping. And I think the district has a GIS person. Does this work overlap with what that person does, or are they doing different GIS work?
Dan, our GIS specialist, did assist with the map we developed, particularly for CAL FIRE at the time of the fire and part of the fire management plan. But he is completing completely separate work, and this was something done completely separate for the fire management plan and providing mapping to CAL FIRE in their particular way they wanted it.
Okay. Okay. Well, thank you. That's all of my questions.
Can I just follow up on that question about the GIS specialist? I can understand how Panorama helped us out during the fire, but some of this is post-fire, like task eight. And I guess I'm just trying to understand what our GIS person does versus what, you know, why we're having to go out and pay a consultant to do this sort of stuff. But I'm just trying to understand that better.
That's a totally separate staff from myself. I don't have any way of getting him that work, but I'm not sure what his schedule looks like or what kind of work he's doing at this time.
You know, we have one GIS person that's working on a lot of the fire recoveries, and we're even going out and hiring, we'll be hiring engineering firms to pick up the work that he cannot get to. And then plus the daily district stuff that we've been working with, our GIS have been working closely with our water supply master plan consultants. We just don't have the bandwidth to do all of this work.
Okay. Jamie, did you have anything you wanted to ask?
No questions.
Are there any comments or questions from the public? Seeing none, hearing none, how about I'll just go back and see if there's any more comments by members of the board? Okay, if not, then what we're asking with recommendation is that we instruct the district manager to enter into a grant to augment Panorama, enter into a contract with Panorama Environmental to continue post-fire response, fire planning, grant writing, and oversight of fuel reduction reforestation implementation. Is there anybody that would like to move that?
Just a point of clarification, is it enter into a contract or is it extending an existing contract?
I don't know the answer to that.
I thought we were extending.
It's an augmentation, sorry. Okay. So I should have said that, that this is the district augments the Panorama Environmental Inc. contract to continue post-fire response, fire planning and grant writing and oversight of fuel reduction reforestation implementation. So it's just augmenting.
In the amount of $37,445. And I will make that motion.
Okay, any seconds?
Second that.
Okay. Any other comments by members of the board or members of the public about that motion? Seeing none, hearing none, Holly, would you take a roll call vote on that?
Excuse me, President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Yes.
Director Ackman?
Yes.
Director Fultz?
Yes.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
So we can go on to the next item of new business, which is the investment policy. Rick, are you going to do this or Stephanie?
Yes, item 10C, the investment policy. We have the finance manager here to present this item to the board. Stephanie?
Attached, you'll find the investment policy that is slightly updated and rewritten a little bit, just to get it a little bit more detailed. And then part of it is also each year the board is to appoint a treasurer that manages the investment policy. And so there is a resolution attached to cover the investment policy and appointing the district manager as the treasurer for the district's investment. And my motion that I put in there, it should be by resolution of the board instead of motion.
Lois, would you like to comment, or is that it? Just Stephanie, are you finished?
Yes, I'm finished. I could add that the Budget and Finance Committee did review this document. So if there's any further questions, we can kind of go over that.
So I was going to start with Lois since she chairs. Yeah.
You know, this is in my bailiwick, investments. And I've read this over and we talked about it at budget meetings. I think this is a very good policy, updated. One of the things that I always worry about is when people invest, sometimes they lump too many things together. But this policy addresses that, so that things aren't maturing at the same time. And of course, they look at the safety of whoever the district's investing in, or with, I should say. So I think it's a great policy. I don't have any objections or questions.
Okay. Mark, did you have anything you wanted to comment on?
One question only. How much unexpected cash do we have in a typical month or a typical period that we are investing?
So it's not necessarily flowing by month. We hold the majority of the district's excess cash in the highest bearing, you know, liquid accounts, which is the Santa Cruz County Fund or the LAIF account. And so we just kind of have our Wells Fargo checking account as kind of a in and out. So it's not chunks of money being invested, you know, in and out multiple times per year necessarily. It more so right now, the majority sits in the Santa Cruz County Fund that's earning us the most interest.
Okay, I see. Thank you. That's it.
Jamie, did you have anything you wanted to ask?
So I appreciate the update to the policy, and I think you sort of answered my question because I was trying to understand how frequently we you know would have a quarterly report on the you know investment earnings. But it sounds like mostly this is like a liquidity holding account that gives us some flexibility and a little bit of earnings on that money, and you know we're not really looking for anything that's going to produce substantial ongoing earnings. Is that a fair characterization?
Correct, and it's almost supposed to be that way. You know, government agencies, you're not supposed to be, you know, gambling. You're supposed to have it in kind of a safe, you know, something that's earning you some interest. So each quarter, we do, you know, we do have, you know, it shows how much interest the district's made. And then we do have the monthly cash report that also is part of the package. So like you said, it's not going to be some, you know, super big, exciting thing. You know, eventually we'll probably be able to invest in some CDs and different stuff like that. But yeah, it's not meant to be huge interest bearing.
Safety first.
Okay.
Jamie, did you have another question?
No, thank you.
Okay. Bob.
So just a little history before I get into my comment. There was a point in time when the district did have a substantial amount of money as a result of the Waterman Gap sale back in early 2000s. And there was an investment policy in place at the time and the board was not following it. And so that's one of the reasons why it became a hot button item for a few years until we got all that straightened out into basically what we have now. Stephanie, just to make sure I understand, most of the funds that we have invested right now are from our proceeds from the loans. Is that correct?
Correct. That's by far the majority that we have sitting in there. And so those are restricted earning interest, which is great. And then we do have, you know, our couple million, about $3 million, that's our capital and operating reserves sitting there as well.
The capital operating reserves were refreshed by the loan, correct?
Correct.
That we had spent all that money in fire emergency, and we basically refreshed that with a loan. So based on what you said earlier then, my understanding is that we really aren't taking any risks at all with that kind of loan money. It is, in fact, in these two extremely safe funds, the Santa Cruz County and LAIF. Are those staggered in any way, or are those just basically we put money in, we earn funds?
Pretty much you just put the money in, you earn funds. We are keeping the majority with the county. For one, it's local, and for two, they've had a history of earning more, slightly more than LAIF over the last couple years.
Right, great. So yeah, we're not doing anything really that would be exercising the boundaries of this investment policy at this point in time. That may change in the future, but at this point in time, this is all totally safe. We're not gonna lose any of our loan money, et cetera.
Correct.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. With that, let's go out and see if we have any comments from the public. I don't see any or hear any. With that, I'll go back and why don't I go ahead and state the recommendation.
Chair Mayhood, may I jump in here for just a second? In the course of the explanation of the item, I realize that it's not clear in the resolution who is designated as the treasurer. And if that needs to be clearly designated, then I recommend pulling this item and bringing it back with something to make it clear who is serving in that role, because it's an important responsibility.
Well, it says appoint the district manager to the treasurer role.
Yeah. I thought
if you want, I could add Rick Rogers' name. I'll do
I,
that. It is covered in the recommendation that's at the bottom of the page.
Right. Well, the treasurer is a role that's established by code. And if it doesn't already, if it hasn't been defined elsewhere in the district's sort of organizational materials, I think it needs to be done in a way that's more formal than.
I don't believe that it has, but maybe that's something to look into.
I don't follow you, Gina. What do you mean? Not more formal.
It's not in the resolution. This is the resolution adopting the investment policy refers to the treasurer without saying who that is. And I think we ought to clarify in the resolution who that is if it's not already established somewhere in the district.
Is that something we could take a brief recess and you could write up quickly so that we can do that here?
Just revise that to say hereby delegated to the district treasurer who is the district manager, Rick Rogers.
I think you'd want to see what the code says. I mean, I would like to review that code section with council just to be on the safe side.
Very well.
All right, well, let's just go ahead and pull it and you can bring it back for just approve. I mean, it doesn't seem like anybody's got any problems with this, so we can deal with it quickly next time when you've revised the wording. There's no big urgency on this. So unless there's objections from members of the board, I'm just going to say let's bring this back at the next meeting.
That's fine.
Okay. All right. So onward. Fish.
Our next item is item 10D, is the Fall Creek Fish Ladder construction, which staff was planning to bring as bids closed beginning of the week to bring this to the board for award of a construction contract. The district received no bids for this project. In trying to identify why we didn't receive bids, district engineer, the engineering committee chair, and myself met and discussed and how to move forward. We reached out and contacted the three contractors that showed a great interest in bidding to find out why they didn't complete a bid. And basically it came back to contractors felt that there wasn't enough time allowed to prepare bid documents. We had a very short bid time frame, approximately 2 weeks. We thought that would be adequate. However, with people's work schedules, it was not adequate. So the three contractors all said it was due to timing. So we decided to do an addendum to the original bid and to extend the bid period 3 additional weeks, in which all contractors felt that they could submit bids, all three of them. So we're moving in that direction, so there's no action to be taken tonight regarding this item. If Mark, Director Smalley, the engineering committee chair, would like to add to that, I'm more than happy for comments.
Yes, I would. I met with Rick and the engineering manager earlier this week to talk about how to proceed on this. We talked about several options, including the possibility of including liquidated damages in a contract, but setting a firm fixed date on that has a significant downside. We also talked about the possibilities of delaying this by on the order of 9 or 10 months until next year. And we didn't think that that was favorable also. Engineering manager contacted these firms, got their concurrence that yes, if we did extend this by 3 weeks, they would submit bids. So the consensus of the group was, let's move forward then with this and put some additional language into the addendum as to what the necessary deadline is for completing the work, the portion of the work that's within the stream itself. So.
Bob, if you don't mind, I'll let Rick just go on to the next thing, which is also going to end up just being kind of a informational item. And then we can come back and take questions on both.
Makes sense.
Yeah, because, so Rick, go ahead and just report on the
item 10E, the Fall Creek Fish Ladder Construction Management Contract, obviously goes hand in hand with the construction. We did have two bidders. They were quite apples and oranges on cost. The district engineer is evaluating both of those and we'll be in a better position to bring back. There's no sense awarding a bid for a construction manager when we don't have a construction project. So we will bring both these items back in hopes of moving this project forward in this year's construction. I mean, this has been Carly and previous her predecessor. The district has worked on this fish ladder permitting process for I think over 6 years now. We received 100% of our permits. We want to get this constructed before prices increase more. So we're working with contractors and the regulatory agencies to get this done, and we will bring this back to the board.
Bob, did you have a question on either of those?
I do, because this project has been, I think, something of a career for Rick, I think, unfortunately. It goes back even further than 6 years. Rick, do we, given three more weeks, do we have time to finish the part of the project that's in the stream before October 15th?
Yeah, obviously that's a great question. That was our number one concern. That's why we started with a short bid time. But we talked about, you know, possibly extending hours maybe so they could work weekends. And we talked about working with the contractor on completing the in-stream work first. You know, right. Get out of the stream. You know, that's the big concern, this October 15 deadline that, you know, Fish and Wildlife and the regulatory agencies want all equipment out of the stream before first rains. So it's going to take some project management. And when the district engineer contacted the three, and these three are all what I would consider, you know, long-term reputable firms in the county that have worked for the district in the past. They have good working relationships with the district. They all felt that they could complete the project. So, you know, we're looking positive on moving forward. You know, definitely we want to be out of the stream by that deadline. And we think that we've got commitments. And that was pointed out in the addendum quite strongly. This is not the district's deadline, so to speak. This is the regulatory agencies. So we feel comfortable on moving forward.
Just don't want it to go another year.
No, we don't either, but you know, not to get off subject, but this will be an issue we'll bring back to the engineering committee about contractors. I think Jamie mentioned it earlier, finding people to do this work and getting people to bid on our projects is going to be something that we have concerns on that we'll be addressing.
All right, thank you.
Do we have any other comments from the board? Jamie, go ahead.
Wanted to understand do we have funding or grant funding that we were intending to use to pay for this work when we do get the contractor in? But you know, we're not in any, you know, if we don't meet these deadlines, we're not in any jeopardy in terms of like losing funding for this work. I mean, are we going to be fined if we don't hit that deadline? Like what, you know, I'm a little concerned about the October 15th deadline and I guess I don't understand what happens if we slip. It sounds like we have missed it in the past.
Well, you know, the deadline has to do with, you know, weather related of being in the stream during rainfall. And we feel comfortable that our contractors will be out of the stream. The funding for the construction portion of this project is 100% district capital funds. Unfortunately, we have no grants or any time-sensitive funding for this project. So we're good in that, and the money is in the bank, so to speak.
Okay. Lois, did you have anything you wanted to add?
Yes. Okay, I understand that the district is paying for this 100% and that there are like four state agencies that are having us do this. Like the only one I can think of the name right now is Fish. It used to be Fish and Game. It's Fish and Wildlife. So there's three other organizations. And I know this needs to get done. I care about the fish. But it really bugs me that we can be made to do something by these separate organizations and they don't pay a dime. And I can just be bugged about it and there's nothing I can do about it. And I'll totally go along with this and believe that we're gonna get this done by prior to October 15th as needed. But it just doesn't sit right with me.
Well, I imagine a lot of people kind of feel that way, Lois. Let's go out to the public now that we've heard from the board, the first round. Rick Moran.
Yes, thank you. Rick Moran from Ben Lomond. I'm sorry to hear the latest news about the, but I had prepared some remarks that I wanted to make, and so I'll just use this opportunity to plant the same seed, okay? Since becoming directly involved with the water district some 6 years ago, the Fall Creek Fish Ladder has been a project that has been of great interest to me. My wife, Chris, lived on Fall Creek Road when she was in elementary school. The state park was her playground. She introduced me to Fall Creek's beauty and history. Whether as a member of the environmental committee or the board, I always supported this project. Now, as work may soon begin, and it will soon begin, I want to make one suggestion. I'm not an engineer or a fish biologist, but my many years as a house painter, I've learned that appearances matter. So the fish will get improvement, the pipes and pumps will get an improvement. I want to make sure the neighbors and the many visitors will have a safe and aesthetically pleasing experience. Fencing should reflect the importance of this project. We should not settle for a simple chain link fence. The fence should be neighbor friendly and not try to hide the pumping equipment. It would be great if a few fencing alternatives could be presented to the board for public review. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rick. Can you just remind me, Lois and I took a field trip there, and am I correct in remembering that there was going to be kind of an explanatory sign that will be put up by the fish ladder so that everybody understands what we're doing there? And I hope, you know, that it seems like a great form of advertising.
Hey, Carly, you want to address the intuitive sign?
Right, so as part of our former education grants that the district used to do for the community, we do have a sign designer already on board. She was funded by one of those grants. And because of the changes in the design throughout the last few years, we have held off on completing it. But now that we have the 100% design and it sounds like we are going to construction, we have Nina Moore working with us and we should have that completed around the same time that the construction is completed.
Great, good. Okay, any other comments by members of the board?
I actually have another comment or question. On what Rick Moran said. Surely we can't put a fence up before this work is done, because when Gail and I looked at where the fish ladder and the small space there, it was like, we're looking at that thinking, this is going to be a very difficult, expensive job. And how are they gonna get in here and do all this work? So I don't know if Rick Moran was talking about a fence before the work or after the work, but I don't see how there could be one before.
I think he would.
So Rick, Rick Rogers, can you answer that?
I think Rick Moran was speaking after the project is completed, the final fencing. There will be construction fencing taken up, put up every night when the construction's over for safety factors, dangerous work site. I think Rick Moran is speaking about the finished product.
Rick, did you want to go ahead and comment on that, Rick Moran, just quickly? Go ahead.
The finished product is what I was concerned about. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Any other questions or comments on our beloved fish and their ladder? If not, we'll go on to the last item of business, which is unfinished business on the fire recovery surcharge.
Thank you, Chair Mayhood. The District Council will present this agenda item to the board. You're muted, Gina.
Thank you. This item is coming to the board for two reasons. The first one is that there was substantial discussion at the last board meeting about ensuring that the fire recovery surcharge revenues would be used solely for fire-related costs. And so, of course, the board is aware that when a new charge is adopted, there's a resolution, or it could be an ordinance, that establishes the parameter of the charge. That would typically be presented to the board for approval at the end of the Proposition 218 process. And the board, assuming that the charge is adopted, would approve that resolution at the end of the hearing. Here, I thought it was important to provide a draft of the resolution to the board in order to ensure that the language related to restricting the funding is satisfactory to the board, so that when the final version of the resolution comes to the board in connection with the hearing, that any issues related to how the funding is being segregated have already been worked out. So that's part of it. There's no board action requested on the resolution. In fact, it would be the board really can't take any action on the resolution tonight, because that wouldn't be appropriate until the conclusion of the Proposition 218 process, assuming there's no public protest. That part of it doesn't require any action. The part of the item that where I am requesting board action is that under the district's policies and procedures related to a Proposition 218 process, the board it needs to appoint a impartial arbiter to be responsible for receiving, collecting, tabulating the ballots, and if needed, where there's a material likelihood that there could be a majority protest. For example, if there's four, the district receives like 40% protests or something like that, close to the 50% threshold, then the arbiter would be responsible for conducting a validation process to determine which of the ballots are actually valid and should be counted. So that appointment I'm bringing to the board tonight, because it really should be made before the district starts receiving Proposition 218 ballots back from customers. So that is the action portion of the item that's requested this evening. Are there any questions about those issues?
So what I'd like to recommend is that we first deal with the action item, which needs to be dealt with now and is, in my mind, pretty straightforward, and that we're determining who the arbiter is. And then we can move on to a discussion of the draft. And basically, this is in response to concerns that people had at the last meeting where we voted to proceed to make sure that we sequester this money in a specific fund. And the good thing about this is it basically Gina and Rich are responding to those concerns, but on the other hand, our positive vote last time didn't delay the process. So we're kind of getting the best of both worlds. So what I'd like to say is that in terms of our discussion of the draft, this is, as far as I'm concerned, this is, you know, we want to get it, this all worked out tonight, if we can. And then we'll just sort of take an informal poll if everybody's happy with it. As Gina said, we can't really vote. So the first thing that we're looking at is the question of the motion would be to appoint the district secretary to serve as an impartial arbiter to receive, collect, and tabulate protests received by the district and, if necessary, to validate the protests during an open public meeting. So are there any members of the board that have any questions or comments on that particular issue? Jamie.
I saw Lois put her hand up too before me. She was a little quick. Either way. So my comment was this, and it's a little bit separate from both of these issues. I noticed at the last board meeting that I think there was, you know, some concern from the public that they just wanted to have more information about what the fire recovery surcharge is. And I know that that's part of the outreach process that we have asked the district to engage in. But I was hoping to make a request of staff that perhaps at the administrative committee meeting, if that's appropriate, we could get the opportunity to hear what the plans are and maybe see some of the language that we're going to be using to do the actual public outreach to explain to people what is being proposed and give them an opportunity to make their comments known.
Can we put that off and go back to what I had on the table? Okay, let's try to get this and we can go back to your question. Lois, did you have anything that is on the table right now?
Well, you were talking about having Holly.
Right.
Receive. I don't have actually a problem with Holly, but one thing I discovered in going through a 218 process, people really want somebody who's not involved. Now, granted, the letters are going to come to the district, but people feel leery when if the district is collecting the ballots and then opening the ballots and then counting them. So one way to get around that to me is the ballots come to the district. They're put in a locked box that nobody can open. And then when the time comes to count those, the box is unlocked and somebody, it could be Martha Washington, I don't care, but somebody who's not connected to the district pulls those out and they are counted. That they aren't counted by the district or taken out of the box by the district. I know what happened when we had 218 a vote, like say on the merger with SLV, and people were lurking around and watching everything. They wanted to make sure we weren't pulling a fast one, and that could happen.
Okay, let's let Gina and maybe Rick comment on that.
Yeah, I have a few responses to that, which is there are, I'll be honest, Lois, absent hiring a consultant to handle the entire process, I'm not really sure what the alternative is to having somebody at the district serve in the arbiter role, at least initially. And let me explain that there are some checks on this process. And one of those is that folks can make a public records request for the ballots after the fact, and they have done that before. So if somebody after the fact wants all the ballots, they can get them in order to determine whether theirs in fact was received by the district and counted. So that's one check on the process. Another really important one is that it's actually not that common that the ballot total gets so close to the 50% threshold that they need to be validated. But if that were to happen, that validation process would happen, it would have to happen in a public hearing. The public could watch it, and that would be an opportunity, in fact, if it were necessary, to invite an outside third party to come, you know, notwithstanding the appointment of somebody in the district being in the arbiter role, we could have an outside third party come and help with that process. Just as a practical matter, it's in order to move the process forward, it's very helpful to have a preliminary tabulation at the close of the Proposition 218 hearing. And again, absent appointing a consultant to receive the ballots and collect and count them and have that tabulation prepared, I'm not sure how to do that other than to have a district individual keep that tally and, of course, keep the ballots secure, because we don't want to lose or misplace any of them. But to start creating that tally so that at the close of the hearing, there's a number that represents the maximum possible protests that the district may have received that the board's going to need in order to make a decision of whether to move forward. That said, the district could hire an outside third party to serve in this role. At least legally, I don't think that's necessary, even though it's possible.
I'm not suggesting that there would be anything illegally done by the district. I'm not suggesting that. All I'm telling you is what my experience is, and maybe people are just crazy in Lompico. I don't know. But
Rick, watch your face.
They want to feel assured that their vote came in and telling them that, hey, you can look at all the ballots. Is that really going to satisfy them? I don't know. And I understand what you're saying. And I totally trust SLV. I'm just telling you what my experience has been. And I'm not suggesting that we have to change things, but I think we need to be very careful. That's all.
Rick, can expand on your take on that whole thing?
Yeah, well, you know, Lois has a very valid point, and the experience in Lompico was extremely contentious all the way through. You know, one of the actual elections, we were lost by a vote. We actually brought in the county clerk, Gail Pellin, to tally one time there at the firehouse. And there was, you know, a lot of stress and a lot of tension there going through the Lompico process. As it worked out good. This process, you know, I think there's a lot of support in our community for the fire surcharge, the rebuilding of our system. I don't believe, you know, there'll always be some percentage of our customer base that will have concerns, but I don't think we're gonna see it rise to the level of the protest and so forth, like we've seen it with the Lompico or our last rate increase. Our last rate increase was very contentious, and Holly did a fine job, very open. We did have at least one or two folks come in and actually copy down all the information from the protest. It was a very transparent process, I thought. You want to have a least account the night of the meeting, so you're not spending a lot of time, you know, going through and counting and sorting them out, so to speak. The process worked good for SLV in the past for rate increases. Yes, the Lompico was very different.
And it was a very contentious issue. And I understand why Lois is bringing that up, because that was very contentious. I don't think we'll have that. And I think, you know, our past procedures with our district secretary will work fine. And Gina's points about, you know, the number of protests we have, we may not even have to validate. You know, I'm thinking we won't have to, but, you know, you never know.
Okay. Anybody else want to comment on this particular issue? Okay. Then let's see if there's any members of the public that want to comment on this. Seeing none, hearing none, I'd like to get back to the motion that was recommended by the staff, which is that we appoint the district secretary to serve as an impartial arbiter to receive, collect, and tabulate protests received by the district and, if necessary, to validate protests during an open public meeting. Can I get somebody to move that?
I'll make that motion.
Second it.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Then, Molly, would you take a roll call vote?
President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Yes.
Director Ackman?
Yes.
Director Fultz?
Yes.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Then we'll move on to the second issue, and then maybe we can come circulate back around to what Jamie was asking about how we do outreach. So I hope everybody's been able to see the draft of the resolution. And so what I'd like to do is elicit any comments that people have suggestions for changes, so that these can be incorporated and the staff can create a final version for when we have the hearing on this. And so we'll start with you, Jamie. Do you have any comments, questions?
So the language of the resolution is fine. And I appreciated that. I think that you handled the question of identifying a specific account in which the recovery revenues would be isolated. That satisfied, I think, the spirit of what the board was asking for. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
Bob?
I had a question for Gina, and just to make sure I understood what she had said during her introductory remarks. Gina, are you saying that it is that the district and this board is legally restricted from offering to the community this level of guarantee prior to the vote by the community on whether or not to have a surcharge like this?
No, and I apologize for sort of confusing the issues. The concern about having the board vote on something like this arises because the language is embedded in the resolution that establishes the new rate, and it would be a Prop 218 violation to approve that resolution before we finish the Prop 218 process. So it's not that the board can't vote on language to create a restricted fund, for example, in advance of the 218 hearing, but it most naturally would be part of the resolution as it is presented to you, and that cannot be voted upon until the hearing and protest procedures are complete.
But it could have been part of the 218 resolution that we voted on last time. We just chose not to do it at that point. And that was my concern about it, is that, you know, in pursuit of maximum flexibility on what to do with the 5 million, I think we shortchanged ourselves on the transparency side by not giving our community those assurances up front. And what we're kind of doing here is sort of a, well, maybe yes, maybe no, trust us, rather than just saying, hey, this is just part of the deal right from the start. As of right now, the most recent budget document does not reflect this. And so, until we have that, I don't know how to square the desire to basically approve it tonight without having everything sort of wrapped up and finalized. So my objection to this process remains, which is we should have done this before, and we should have tried to lessen the impact on our community by finding operating cost savings to reduce this, even if it were a million. This past year has been horrific for many people in our community relative to their income levels. And so we're just sort of continuing what I think is a less than positive experience here. With respect to the specific language, I went back and looked at what we reviewed last time, and there seemed to be at least one area that was different, and that was the when will the proposed surcharge end. And what we reviewed last meeting, it was either a total of $5 million or terminated early if the net costs are less than $5 million. I think we have slightly different language in this one.
Well, I mean, it might be slightly different, Bob, but
that's the point. You might think it's trivial, and you might cut me off because you think it's trivial, but it's not. We should be very consistent in the messaging that we're giving people. And I think that actually goes to what Jamie probably wants to talk about, which is what is that messaging? How should we be doing it? And we should be reviewing all of that in depth prior to rushing in to the vote that we took. So I would like to see, I mean, you asked for comments, so I'm giving you comments. I would like to see that we harmonize the language that's in this particular resolution with what we had talked about at the last meeting.
Do you have a suggestion for how to change the...
I told you what the suggestion was. It was the surcharge terminated early if the wildfire costs are less than $5 million. Now, do I believe that that might happen? I don't know. Strange things happen. But that's what we put in our agenda item last time.
I could be misremembering, but I thought that was a note in either the 218 notice or the memo indicating that the board could terminate the charge early, which is absolutely the case under 218, but I wouldn't typically put that in the resolution because that's a decision the board would make at a later time.
But that is part of the communication to the community. And so, we obviously have very different approaches on transparency and building trust and communicating with the community. One is a legal approach, one is not. And what I've advocated for here consistently from the time this was brought to the board for its discussion and approval was a very different process. If we choose not to do that, okay. But I think we're really missing opportunities here to engage with our community in a much better fashion. The reality of this is, the larger the agency, the less likely that a negative vote, which is just a complete inversion of our system of government, it's less likely that a negative vote will be successful. Only in small circumstances will that happen. Our Bear Creek Estates sewer area, for example, which has 56 people, did easily defeat one of the proposals because they were able to organize a very small community. You get to the size of San Lorenzo Valley Water District, it's very difficult for that to happen in the very short period of time that's available to people. So it's not likely, as Rick says, it's not likely to happen, even if there was opposition to it. But I really think because of that, we need to make sure that we're going the extra mile when we're communicating with our customers and our owners.
Lois.
Well, I understand what Bob is saying about how difficult it is to defeat a 218 process. But to go back to this question of keeping track of the money, it is such a simple thing. It's an account. It's a part of what Stephanie does on a regular basis. And they can keep track of where all that money is going, what account it goes into, and as it's spent, coming out and describing what it was spent on. And it seems like we're making a mountain out of a molehill here. This is just a simple process for any accountant to keep track of money that comes in for a certain purpose, and the money goes out for that purpose. And anybody, any member of the public can look at that. Now, whether we shut it off early or we don't shut it off early, we don't know what's going to happen. We don't really know how much FEMA's going to pay. There's a lot of things that we don't know. And maybe we need more than $5 million. Are we going to say we're only going to collect $5 million? I don't know. I just seems like this shouldn't be so difficult to me. And maybe just because I've done accounting and I understand the in and outs, but I would think Bob knows that. This is not rocket science. That's all.
Mark, did you want to make a comment?
Yes. Lois, I don't think that Bob's point was regarding how the funds are tracked. It's when the funds are no longer being collected. But I'm okay with the resolution the way it is written, but I understand Bob's point about not having the language in there for stopping the collection of this if the costs are less than the $5 million. So just that comment.
I guess since I haven't commented here, I would just second what Mark said. And I guess, Bob, just because we don't always agree on everything doesn't mean that I'm not devoted to transparency and developing trust with the ratepayers. I think all of the board members are. And I think that's one of the good aspects of this board, that they're all engaged and they are devoted to these ideals. Again, I'm perfectly open to you adding a sentence there that where it says shall end automatically once a total $5 million surcharge of revenues are collected by the district, comma, or, you know, if you would come up with a specific language. But sometimes I get the feeling that what you're trying to do is obstruct a process without suggesting a way to make it more acceptable to you. So I would just urge you to just give us the language, and I think some of us would probably vote for it. I mean, I know I would. Bob, go ahead.
Well, I appreciate that, but you know, I gave the specific language when I was talking about it. And sorry, so apparently it was not, and I gave the specific suggestion on how to do it. So let's set
I'm that sorry. Aside for just, I missed it.
For so just a moment.
It's my fault.
Because, well, okay. But that is a recurring theme that you have, and I don't accept that premise, and I want to make that very clear. Here's where I'm coming from and where I struggle. I don't think there's any question here that our community is basically on the hook for the repair costs that aren't covered by the generosity of the taxpayers of the United States. We might get some additional grants, we might get some funding from the state, but we are on the hook for this. So I think we can all agree, and I think we all do agree on that. And I think even the community would agree on that as well. And I agree with Lois that handling this should be a very straightforward thing, but I want to be very clear what my expectation is. Because when I look at the budget as it's currently been presented to us, it does not do that. It throws the $5 million into a big pot and it gets shuffled around. At the end of this process, because we're funding all of this repair work right now through a loan, at the end of this process, when that $5 million has been collected, it either needs to be applied over a period of time to the loan we took out for the fire recovery because we can't prepay that, or we need to prepay $5 million on the other loan. This should not be rolled into the P&L as it currently is instantiated in the budget documents that have been presented to us. And so I'm very interested in seeing how the budget documents come back to us, because that's probably going to be on the next agenda, to make it really clear that that is in fact what's going to happen. Because if that is not clear, then we are not using that $5 million in the correct way. The other option we might do for the $5 million is actually pay cash for some of the fire recovery, but because that $5 million is being collected over a long period of time, we're probably going to be done with the fire recovery well before the end of that five-year period, or at least the vast majority of it, where we're going to be spending most of our money. So, and right now, I don't. This isn't all hanging together for me, and that's the struggle that I have.
Are there any other comments by other members of the board? Jamie.
So I guess I appreciate this conversation. I think I agree that we can add language to the resolution that would better clarify our intentions with the surcharge. You know, and I'll suggest something that I think I heard Bob say, which was something along the lines of, be it further resolved that the wildfire recovery surcharge shall end automatically once a total of $5 million surcharge revenues are collected by the district or earlier at the decision or direction of the board, should the entire $5 million not be required. I know Gina felt like we didn't need to do that, but I think that, you know, the public would appreciate knowing that we are being mindful that it may not be as expensive as it's been priced out to be, although I would be surprised by that. I think that, you know, that can kind of hopefully achieve the spirit of what Bob was hoping for with this specific resolution, you know, at the point that we do eventually adopt it, obviously not tonight. To his larger question about, you know, wanting to know that not only have we created this, you know, isolated account in which the revenues are going to be collected, that will, you know, ensure that they are being directed only to CZU fire recovery costs, but I guess I would love to hear from Rick and Stephanie, you know, whether the next budget is likely to address some of the concerns about how this money will roll into future budgets, in a transparent way. Do you have any thoughts around that?
I mean, I'll let Stephanie step up first, but we can, you know, create accounts and show accounts in the budget. That's not an issue. If that's what the board
correct wants. And I think that's what we said at the last meeting, is that we'll break it out similarly to the other reserve fund area, to where it'll be a designated restricted. it's going to be considered operating revenue no matter what, but we'll just have it flow directly down to the bottom as showing restricted.
Okay, thank you. I think that, you know, being able to see that and visualize that when we get the next round of budget documents will be really helpful for that discussion. And, you know, I just wanted to revisit my other question separately, which was just that I would love just a quick presentation from staff about what is done when as we go through the Prop 218 process to, you know, help people understand what their role is in it. Because, you know, I very much appreciate the concerns that people have that feel like they don't know what the process is and they don't understand what we're doing. And maybe they don't understand, you know, what this money is actually going to do or why we need it. You know, I wanna make sure that we're really answering those questions in a fulsome way.
Understand.
Jamie, do you want them to do this now or do you want them to do it at some later date?
No, I am asking them for a future presentation. I don't want to put them on the spot right now, but you know, maybe we could, and that's why I was suggesting maybe at the administrative committee meeting even, that's something that we could take up and discuss there. And you know, I'm open to how we do that, but I would just like to learn more about that for my own understanding, because I do hear from people about like, well, what are they doing to tell us this is happening?
Rick, I'll let you answer whether you would like to do this at a general board meeting or let you consider whether you want to agendize it for a general board meeting or whether you would rather take it.
You know, I think let staff regroup the first of next week and put together what we're going to say. You know, I have a tendency to want to, just because of the, you know, the magnitude of this issue, the full board. I'd like to include Gina in that discussion and Stephanie on how we're going to move this ahead. You know, I have no problem bringing this information back that Director Ackman has asked for. I just want to make sure that we follow a process that legal is comfortable with and move forward. Most likely the full board, just because of the magnitude of the issue. It may require a special meeting. I'm not sure. That's what I say. Like to group up with staff and get back to you all.
Okay, that seems reasonable. I'm not really sure where to go from here. Jamie suggested some language, which I don't know whether she wants to formally propose to add in there or whether at this point it might just be better to let this go, let Gina take the substance of what she's heard and revise the document. I think I heard Holly saying that she was happy with the way it was. I'm happy with the way it was. I don't know, Mark, what's your take on this?
Although I did say I was okay with the resolution, I appreciate what Bob's point is, and can agree with the language that Jamie was proposing or something like that, because I don't think that encumbers the resolution any.
I think
letting Gina take a step back,
okay,
take this and reflect that into it.
Yeah, I agree. I thought that it takes a little, I started trying to come up with some language similar along the lines of what Jamie did, and it's going to take more time than I can, you know, we can just do.
Don't think we need to do that here tonight.
Yeah.
And I think Gina and myself, you know, staff has direction. We understand where the board's coming from. And that's why we came back. We know the board wants the intent of this money to be spent only on CZU. And that's why we brought it back. And, you know, we have time to massage it one more time and we'll come back with something.
Okay.
Could I say something here?
Yes, go ahead.
Well, the 218 process really defines what you're voting on and who can vote and what it's all about. It's all spelled out when somebody, when it goes out to the public. It has to go out to everyone and tells them what the process is. So I can see clarifying what the surcharge is for. But as for the process, it's clearly defined. It always, people have to be told that it's a negative vote. They and normally it's like only one vote for a connection. It's not both people that live there, you know, man and a wife or a woman with 10 kids. It's one vote normally per connection. And that all that stuff is spelled out in the 218 process. And it should answer most questions. Maybe it won't necessarily answer the question why the surcharge, but I think most people get that we have a problem here, a financial problem from the fire. And so maybe that isn't even going to be a big issue. I don't know. And I know I don't know everything, but I've had a certain experience with 218 processes. And they're very clear normally. And SLV isn't new to this. They've done it many times.
I agree. There's a lot of constraints that are imposed by the process itself, the legal aspects, what we do in terms of outreach and other things. So I think it's a good idea that Rick and staff bring this back to the rest of the board. So with that, unless there's any other comments, we can move on. Bob?
Yeah. So a couple of comments. I think the Lois is very right. It is spelled out, but because at a cultural level, this Prop 218 negative vote is completely foreign to our way of governing, I think that's why people have such a hard time with it. It's an inversion of how they normally think about voting. One person, one vote. This doesn't do it, and it turns it from a yes to a no. Yeah, but the main thing I wanted to say is I think Jamie had a really good suggestion. Because the messaging around this and the work that we would do in that, I think is really critical. Past 218 processes have sold certain things, and we need to be very clear about what we're selling. I think Rick likes to talk about how, you know, we sold the probation tank a couple times in 218 processes. And so people have that in mind as well. We need to make sure this is very clear. So I really like the idea of a more review of the communications process. In addition, because it's very clear that we're gonna be going back to the community for yet another rate increase after this next one, sometime in the near future, I think this would be really good for us to get these communication processes in place really well. Sort of a, I don't want to call it a practice run, but certainly this one is a great one for us to be able to work on in preparation for the one that comes after.
Okay, any other comments from the board or from our public members, four of them that are still hanging in there with us? If not, the final thing we have are district reports and written communications. And
Chair Mayhood, did I miss the vote on appointing the district secretary as the arbiter?
Unanimously positive. We did that before we moved on to the discussion of the resolution. Did we not? Am I imagining?
We did.
You're correct. It was a unanimous vote. In favor.
Okay, anything else, Gina?
No, thank you, Chair Mayhood.
So there, the only thing that we have under district reports was, I was just gonna make a brief one about what's coming up. And on June 17th, you've probably heard that we have a hearing on the draft urban water management plan. So what that means, given that, and the fact that we don't have a meeting in the first meeting of July is canceled, according to the board policy manual. I will give, and Mark and I will give a presentation on sort of an update on the Santa Margarita process on July 15th, that meeting. And that is still well before the public comment period is started. And I will say that one interesting thing came out today, California Water Department announced its first assessments of the groundwater sustainability plans that were sent in last, 16 months ago for those groundwater basins that were critically overdrawn. So those, the example that you probably know about is the Santa Cruz Mid-County one that has severe problems with seawater intrusion. And we're kind of the next category down. We're overdrawn, but not critically overdrawn. And the interesting thing that they announced was that Santa Cruz Mid-County, their plan was approved, as was the a particular basin aquifer in Monterey. The two of them were sent back as being categorized as inadequate. This is Kiama Valley Basin and the Paso Robles Subbasin. So that was interesting. That it's the first time we've actually seen any evidence that anybody in California Water Department actually looked at these reports. From the standpoint of our situation, it's encouraging because we're using the same consulting group that Santa Cruz County did that got their plan approved. So that sort of, I think, bodes well for us when we send ours in January. So that's all I wanted to point out. Polly, you've got your hand up.
Yes, I just wanted to let you know that we are having a July 1st Board of Directors meeting. We decided at the beginning of the year that it was not necessary to skip that meeting. And so we are scheduled to have a July 1st meeting.
I thought we voted on that, and I checked the board policy manual that we accepted, and it says that we don't have... That's 1 month where we only have one meeting, and it's the second one. That's definitely in the board policy manual because I looked it up because I couldn't remember, and I think there was a split in the vote on that. Can anybody else?
I actually thought that Holly's right I didn't agree with it, but I know I'm pretty sure the majority of it voted to have a board meeting on July 1st.
That is correct.
Okay, because that's not what is in the board policy manual right now that we passed on April 15th.
That's how it had been in the past, but this year we changed it to.
I was puzzled too because I was on the opposite side of Bob, but when I looked at the thing, I don't know what to do about that, Gina.
Well, I think that the board policy manual, since it was adopted by resolution after the resolution initially setting the meeting schedule for the year, superseded that prior decision. And so now the schedule is that there's only one regular meeting in July.
I think that's correct. Because I think the first vote that you're referring to, Bob, was when we were setting the calendar. And but then when we reconsidered it, the vote went the other way. In the direction that you preferred. I think I would prefer that we, well, not prefer, I think we must stick with what the board policy manual says. Is it right, Gina? I mean, I we can't like have another.
Yeah, I think it superseded the prior decision. Regular meetings have to be established by a formal board action. I think the resolution, formal board action, adopting the policy manual superseded the prior action.
Right. I agree. And that doesn't mean we can't have a special meeting or something if we want to, but we won't be a regular meeting. Okay, Holly, got that? And any other questions or comments on the Santa Margarita stuff? Okay. Well, any other questions or comments that anybody wants to make before we adjourn for the evening? Hearing none, seeing none, then nighty night. Thank you all.
Good night.